Welcome to the course overview for GoLang for Taurus. In this overview, I'd like to tell you a little bit about what Go is, sometimes called GoLang. Especially when you search for information online, I'll talk a little bit about why I think you should learn Go, why I learned Go. We'll talk a little bit about this course, why you might want to take this course. There are many other courses. We'll look at the course objective. What is it that you are expected to gain by the end of this course? Then we'll talk about some of the prerequisites that I expect you to have to be successful in this course. What is it that you need to do? And then finally, I'll show you the course outline, which is all the material that we intend to cover in terms of the topics that we intend to cover. Let's start with what is Go. Go is a programming language that was developed by Google, and it started development around 2007, but it was made public about 2009. Go is often, like I said, referred to as GoLang Online. Important things to know about Go is that Go is open source, which means that you can download it, look at it, you can make suggestion, contribution, if that's your thing. It's also cross-platform. And this is important. There's a good chance that there's Go available for whatever architecture and OS you're on. Another benefit of Go is that it was designed to be simple, reliable, and efficient. Now, these things are often in conflict, and it's not always that you can get a language that is simple, reliable, and efficient. Let's take a language like C and C++. C and C++ are very efficient. They run very well. They generate code that makes the best use of your processor. However, when it comes to simple, most people would not consider a language like C++ simple. I think C is simple, but still, number of people would find that it's still a difficult language. And in terms of writing reliable code, you can write reliable code in almost any language, but just some language make it more difficult. With Go, it's designed to make writing simple, reliable, and efficient code. Another thing about Go is that it's a compiled and statically typed language. So let's work backwards through that statement. It's statically typed, which means that everything in Go has a well-defined type that remains the same from the time that you declare a variable, for example. And if you don't know anything about variables, don't worry about it. It's basically is once you have a placeholder for some sort of value, a value being like a name, age, social security number, something like that. Once you have you've allocated storage for that, the type associated with that storage or that allocation remains the same and does not change. This is different from languages like Python or JavaScript, where you can have a variable and you can assign a string in one line, 10, for example. On line 10, you assign it a value of type string, and then on the very next line, you assign it a value of type integer, like the number 35. And so these are called dynamically typed languages, but Go is not dynamically typed. Now, compile. This is compared to languages like Python, which are interpreted languages, which means that they have an interpreter that takes your source code, and as it goes through line by line, it's producing result. There's something that's really, really nice about what Go does, and Go creates statically linked files. Now, what that means, and this does not have to do with static type. Static type has to do with the placeholder that you have for values. Statically linked means that once Go creates an executable, remember everything is compiled, once it creates a binary, that binary has everything it needs to run. Also, you can create executables for another platform. So, for example, when you're developing code, let's say on a Mac, and your buddy wants something on Windows or Linux, you can easily generate an executable for your friend for another platform. So that's really, really cool. Another key feature of Go is that, as implemented today, Go is a garbage collected language. And that means that they have taken the time to build in a lot of memory safe features. So for example, you have a language like Java that's garbage collected, but you can run into issue where things get really bogged down and really slow, and you have to try and tune it and pass a number of parameters to the JVM and the GC to tune how it runs. In Go, that is not the case. They've taken care of most of the thing for you, and they've made it very safe to use. And so Go feels like C because you have pointers, but you have no pointer arithmetic, which means that you cannot say, I have a pointer and I had a value to it and get some out of memory location. So you cannot do unsafe things, but you can get the benefit of using pointers. If pointers scare you, don't worry. I promise. I treat pointer very, very differently than how you might have seen it presented before. And we cover pointers in section 9, and we take our time and we go through it with nice animation and images to illustrate what a pointer is, and then we do some nice code example that really try to illustrate it with simple exercises. Finally, Go has something called CSP style concurrency. What is CSP? CSP stands for Communicating Sequential Processes. Now, if you read that backwards, you'll see it just means processes that are sequential. So all this is processes that run sequentially that can communicate with each other. And if you can pull that off, and because you have the support in the language, then if you have multiple cores, well, those processes don't need to run sequentially. They can run in parallel. So why might you learn Go? So I've mentioned a number of features that Go has. Like, it's simple, it tends to generate reliable code, efficient code, it has built-in concurrency, it's statically typed. These are all good things. And all those are reason enough to want to learn this language. But Go is not the only language that does features. So why else might you want to learn Go? Well, job security. A number of companies are exploring Go and give you new opportunities to explore. Now, another point is actually it's fun and fairly easy to write Go code. And what you find is that once you start writing Go code, you enjoy just finding other applications to write in Go. Things that you've done before or any new project or anything, you always think of, how can I do this in Go? Just because it's so much fun. And one reason that it's fun to write in Go is that not only is the language, as I said, was designed to be simple, but the syntax and the number of keywords, the things you have to know, is fairly small. And so you can remember pretty much everything about the language. And so it allows you to become proficient very easily. And that really makes it fun because you can do very, very cool things. And we're going to demonstrate it. We're going to see how we're going to be able to write simple network and application. We're going to be able to write an application, for example, that runs a command remotely. We're going to be able to write an application that puts up a web page and allows you to interact with it. All of that with some very, very simple Go code. And like I said, it has built-in concurrency. So why is this important? Today, our computers are getting more processors, not necessarily faster processors, but just more of them. And being able to write programs that take advantage of concurrency patterns means that when you run those programs on computers with multiple processors, you can get parallelism. And so you get the best use of all of those cores or CPUs in your computer. And because Go was designed with concurrency in mind, it means that it's easier to implement and reason about what is going on in your application. Now, I mentioned this before, that because it's so much fun and fairly easy to write code in Go, and because the language is fairly small in terms of the number of keywords and the concepts and so on that you have to remember, well, you feel like if you're an expert fairly soon, and so you get to build really interesting software. And this gets coupled with the concurrency feature. So all these things come together to allow you to really build like interesting software. So why this course? Well, the scope. One reason that I think you might like this course is the way that the material is presented. We cover major features of the language, but we don't try to do everything. Almost any topic that we're going to cover, I'll show you the list of topics very soon. We can go very, very deep, but that wouldn't help us in terms of getting you up and running. Now, course objective wise, this course is to build a foundation for everyday Go programming. You're going to leave this course knowing everything you need to know about the major features of Go and how to use them and how to build on that. You're going to know about the structure of a Go application. You're going to be able to use arrays, slices, maps, and of course, learn concurrent programming with Go routines and channels. We're going to also look at how to manipulate data. We look at getting data from files and even some network programming. And all of this is going to be done through illustrative examples. So what is it that you need to have to be successful in this course? What you need to know is how to navigate your computer. And if you can do that and use a basic text editor, then you can be successful in this course. You do not need to come with prior programming experience. If you're a programmer and you know another programming language, then great. This is a great foundation for learning a new language. But if you're not a programmer, I also try to present the material in such a way that you can understand it. And where necessary, you can go and find extra help. And I give you some pointers for additional material you should read if you're a non-programmer. So if you're prepared to do the extra work, you'll be able to fill in the steps and the gaps that's needed to be successful in this course. In terms of the outline for the course and what topics will be covered, We'll start off in section one by looking at the installation and setup for the tools and the editor we're going to need, what kind of environment we need to be able to write Go code. And then finally, we will wrap up by showing that our network programming is not very different from reading and writing to file or even using standard I/O. That is the overview for this course. I look forward to seeing you in the remaining lecture. Take care.